evolution. And as a part of that, we want to discuss about the wisdom. So if you recall, in first few lectures, we talked about human desire and its fulfillment. And there were three important conclusions that we drew. Number one was human desire is for continuous happiness. And this desire is related to the need of the self. The second observation was that this continuous happiness in the self is ensured by right understanding, by right feeling and right thought, which are the activity of the self. And this right feeling and right thought in the self is what is called as resolution. So we are resolved within in terms of what we have to do in relationship with other human beings, with rest of nature. That resolution comes when we have the right feeling and the right thought. Then we were trying to explore or investigate into this resolution in detail. And we said that this resolution, or saying that I am resolved within, would essentially mean that I have the clarity about all aspects of my living. So whatever is the extension of my living, right, starting from self to body to the world outside, I must have the clarity of all that. So we try to look into those aspects of our existence which are important for us, and therefore we must have the clarity of all this if we have to be resolved within. So in that sense, we identified these 9 aspects, starting from right understanding, that is having the clarity of the existence as a whole, seeing the reality as it is. Then the wisdom, that is identification of human goal, what I have to do as human being in this existence. Then we have science, that is how to fulfill the human goal that we have identified in wisdom, and so on. Behavior, the work, the participation in the larger order, and undivided human society and universal human order and human tradition. All these are of concern to us because our existence, our living is related to all this. So we said that all this clarity has to be there in the self, and then only we'll be in a state of harmony within and happiness within, and we'll be able to fulfill our basic human desire, which is for continuous happiness. So with this background, we said that we will try to investigate into each of these aspects of our living one by one. So till now, we have been trying to understand, you know, what is right understanding, trying to get the clarity about right understanding. And one of the important conclusions that we made about right understanding is that this right understanding has to do with seeing the reality as it is. And when we look into the details of this, we see that it is the self who is the knower, the one who understands. And the things to be known ultimately is the whole existence, because our living is connected with the whole existence directly or indirectly. Therefore, we need to understand the whole existence. And when you look at this whole existence, this can be approached, you know, in a sequence, starting with the knowledge of human being, then knowledge of distance, and on the basis of these two, knowledge of human conduct. So in module 2, we have tried to investigate into harmony in human being, into, you know, understanding human being and knowledge of human being. In module 4, we tried to understand this existence. And in module 5, this is the last module, this course, first we try to understand the human conduct. So these 3 aspects. In 3, we have covered this understanding human being. In 4, we have covered understanding the existence, and in 5, first 2 lectures, we have covered understanding the human conduct, which is basically a conclusion or a kind of derivation of what we have understood about human being and about the existence. So with this clarity about right understanding, now we want to move down to the other aspects of our living. And this second aspect of our living is wisdom, right? Identification of human goal. So that is what we intend to take up in this session. That is, we want to get back to this all-encompassing resolution, and there we want to discuss about the wisdom after having discussed about the right understanding. So let us look at this wisdom. So wisdom means basically identifying what we have to do as a human being and what we do not have to do as a human being. So what to do and what not to do as a human being. This identification is wisdom. So I should be able to differentiate, discriminate between what I have to do as a human being and what I don't have to do as a human being. So basically, wisdom means identification of human goal. So wisdom is identification of human goal. What is human goal and what is not human goal? This clarity is what we are calling as wisdom. And we have added one statement in the bracket, which is in alignment with existential order. So this is very important, that we are embedded in this existence that we have understood now through module 4. And we are an individual part of this existence, this nature. And therefore, our living has to be in line with, in accordance with this existential order, this existential harmony. So when we are identifying the human goal, we have to make sure that this goal that we are working out is in fact in alignment with existential order, existential harmony, and not otherwise. So this is the writing clause that we have added here, that we want to identify the human goal, which is or which has to be in line with the existential harmony, the existential order, the existential law. So this has to be kept at the back of mind whenever we are talking about human goals. Once we have the right understanding about the existence and about the human being in it, we can visualize the human goal. So if I can understand the existence and I can understand the human being in this existence, then it is possible for me to visualize what is the human goal, which is in line with the existential harmony, existential reality. Now, one important point which has to be brought in here is that when we are trying to visualize this human goal, with the background of understanding of existence and human being, then depending upon our angle of perception, this visualization can be different. So we can have different formulation depending upon our different angle of perception. So this is important to note. That if I am looking at the existence and the human being in existence and trying to identify the goal of human being. This identification, this visualization will depend upon my angle of perception. So from different angle of perception, I may come to different conclusions about the human goal, or at least seemingly looking different conclusions. So that is what we have said. However, this difference will be only at the level of expression, not in essence. So whatever we visualize about the human conduct may look different at the level of expression depending upon our angle of perception, our way of looking at it. But in essence, it will be the same. In a sense, all these different expressions of human conduct will be the same. Different formulations of human conduct will be the same. That we will see also as we go on. We'll see, we'll try to mainly focus on the formulation that we had taken in USB1 and which we have continued in this USB2 also. So mainly we will discuss about that formulation, that visualization. But we will also bring in some other formulation just to kind of draw our attention that depending upon our angle, our concerns of perception, we may have different formulations. But these formulations will be different in details, in expression, and not in essence. In essence, they will be the same. Because the essence is formulated on the basis of understanding of human being and understanding of existence, which is definite, certain. So we'll look into those things. We have taken one such formulation in EHB1, which we will discuss here in detail. But we'll also introduce another such formulation, which has been taken in Indian tradition for a long time. This will help us to see the possibility of different formulations and also help to see certain aspects of human goal more clearly. This is important, that when you have different angles, right, certain things come out very well as compared to formulations which have different angle of perception. For example, if I have the basic angle of perception that there should be order in the society so that it provides a conducive environment for the growth of all, then my formulation of human goal would be one thing. But if I have the perception that I have to come out of this misery of my existence, then probably the visualization of the human goal will be different. And the emphasis in the two cases is going to be very different. So the first one will be more conducive for the, you know, for ensuring the social order. The second one will be more conducive for getting deal of the misery at a personal level. So depending upon that, we will see, you know, these possibilities are there. And if we can see with example two such formulations, it will help us to see that the formulations do depend upon the angle of perception or our concerns. And depending upon that concern, one formulation may be helpful, you know, in certain things as compared to the other formulation. So let us look at this. So according to the formulation taken in EHB1, the human goal can be seen as below. So if we look at this, at the level of self, the human goal is continuous happiness. which we have now formulated as happiness, peace, satisfaction, and bliss. But at the level of society, we had identified these four goals, four human goals. If you remember, the right understanding and right feeling and right thoughts at the level of self in every individual. So if we have the right understanding, right feeling and right thoughts, this leads to a state of happiness, which we have been talking about time and again. So this is the first human goal. Then we have prosperity in every family as the second human goal. Then the fearlessness, trust in society. And then coexistence, mutual fulfillment in nature, in existence. So these are the four human goals which we can identify on the basis of what we have understood about human being, about the existence. And each one of these can be discussed in quite detail, like we have been discussing about this right understanding, right feeling, and right thought, the whole of this course on UHV2. Similarly, we talk about this fearlessness or trust, talk about this relationship quite extensively in UHV3. Similarly, we'll talk about this mutual fulfillment in nature, in existence, in quite detail in that course, UHV3. So this can be discussed in quite detail, but we are not going into that detail now. Anyway, later we are going to go through this in the next course. But here we are briefly bringing it or recalling it for our further discussion. So these are the four human goals. So we as human beings living in society do aspire for all these four things. And we have said that you can all verify whether you do aspire for all of them or anything is unnecessary. So this verification we had done, that these are the goals and each one of them seem to be important. We cannot do away with any one of them. So this is what we identified as human goal at the level of society. Then we also said that now that this is what is the human goal, we can keep it at the base and ask this question to ourselves as to what are we doing today. If we look at ourselves, our family, our society, what is the human goal that is there at the back of mind of each one of us? So if we look at that, then let us ask ourselves, right, as to whether today we identify this as human goal, these four goals mentioned in the yellow blocks, or we are somehow busy with these four blocks with the black color. So this is very interesting to ask. In fact, with all the background that we have now, and some work on the self, on our state of the self or imagination of the self, our feelings, thoughts in the self, And of course, something about the understanding, you know, the higher activities of the self, about the natural acceptance. Now we can really look into this, that are we going by the, you know, human goal as mentioned in the yellow blocks, or are we going with the identification of human goal as this black one? What is it? Each of these questions is very important now. That are we able to see that at the level of self, at the level of individual, the basic goal is right understanding in the self, right feeling and right thought in the self. Are we able to see this as a goal at the level of self, the level of individual? Or at the level of self, at the level of individual, somehow we have some assumptions which are either coming from the society, from the teachers, from the parents, or coming from the sensation. We have assumptions. And most of the time we are busy working with those assumptions. They provide the motivation for our desire. And with that desire, we are busy with the imagination and then expression in terms of work and behavior and so on. For example, one of the assumptions could be that money is everything. Now, this is something which is very commonly now said in this society, that nothing else will work. Right? Only money is going to go, you know, be with you. So your relatives, your parents, your siblings, they can all ditch you. It is the money only which will be there with you. And therefore, accumulate, earn more and more money. So what do you think? What is your state? What is your assumption? Are you working for right understanding, right feeling and right thoughts? Or deep down, you have these assumptions, like money is everything, and you are busy with those assumptions. You are thinking with those assumptions. You are working with those assumptions. So today, if you see good education, education in IITs would mean good job, which would mean good salary, which would mean more physical facility, more money. So are we seeing it like that, or are we able to see that as far as this self is concerned, the individual is concerned, the goal is right understanding, right feeling and right thought in the self. Similarly, we have this prosperity in every family as the goal, or we have this accumulation by any means, at least for myself, or at most for few individuals. So the trend in the society is that at least few individuals should become rich, should have enough, right? As much as they can, because this enough is not defined. Without right understanding, what is enough is never defined. So you want more and more. So more and more accumulation by any means, at least for myself. If it is for some more people, okay, but at least for myself, I have to accumulate more and more. And this some more does not include all. So there is somewhere the belief that, you know, this prosperity cannot be there for everyone. This enough cannot be there for everyone. So, okay, let us see. At least for some, we should be able to do it. And that is what we are doing in this society. So what is the goal for you? Prosperity in the family or accumulation by any means of unlimited physical facility, unlimited money? So now you can see that if we are working for right understanding, right feeling and right thought in the self, and we are working for prosperity in the family, then this is realizable. This can be realized. But if we are going by the assumption that money is everything and we have to accumulate money or physical facility by any means, then the outcome of this, we can see, it results into obsession for convention, obsession for profit, obsession for sensual pleasure. And you can see in this society today, these are the symptoms which have become very predominant. Obsession for consumption, for example, leads to overindulgence, overeating, obese, right? Wastage of natural resources that we are seeing. Therefore, there is problem of pollution and there is problem of resource depletion. And of course, exploitation in the society. So similarly, obsession for profit leads to so much of manipulation and exploitation in the society. And it also leads to social problems like corruption. So the corruption is founded on this obsession for profit, which is founded on the wrong assumptions that we have just discussed. And similarly, obsession for sensual pleasure, right, is quite obvious now. It is becoming one of the very kind of burning issue for the society. And now it has come to the extent that government has to take the decision that the person who is involved in, you know, such cases, a forceful kind of involvement, then he should even be hanged, sentenced to death. But deep down, if you see the problem of this, you know, sexual harassment or, you know, more acute forms of it, is because of this obsession for sensual pleasure, which is because of our wrong assumptions about the self, about the human being, about the existence. Then, if you look at the level of society, is there a feeling of trust, feeling of fearlessness, or there is a feeling of fear in the society? Feeling of fear because there is domination, there is exploitation, therefore there is fear in the society. So is there the trust, the fearlessness, or is there the fear, the exploitation, the domination in society? And if we have this one below with a dark thing, it will result into things like terrorism and war. So this lack of trust, this lack of environment of fearlessness, lack of relationship in the society is ultimately resulting into serious things like war. And as we all know, many of the big countries are investing more than 50% of their resources preparing for war. So majority of the big, you know, nations, including India, is spending more than 50% of their resource preparing for war. And if you analyze this reason for it, it is because of lack of relationship. And even now, if you look at how much of budget we are allocating for preparing for war, and how much budget we are allocating for fulfillment of relationship, you will understand what is our perception, what is our way of looking at things. The fourth goal, that is coexistence, the mutual fulfillment in nature, in existence. Are we working for this? Or we are working for mastery over the nature, exploitation of the nature? And can we see that if we are working for mastery over the nature and exploitation of nature, rather than ensuring mutual fulfillment with nature, then it leads to resource depletion and it leads to pollution. So now ask yourself, are you working for the goals which are mentioned, you know, with these yellow blocks? Or because of our misunderstanding, because of our wrong assumptions, we are working for these goals which have been defined, right, and written down in this black blocks box. What is it? Ask for yourself, what is it for you as an individual? Of course, then we ask, what is it for the whole society today, or predominantly for the whole society today? And now can we see that majority of the problems that we see in the society today, be it the problem of resource depletion or pollution, be it the problem of terrorism and war, be it the problem of corruption, they all are related to our wrong identification of the human goal. And this wrong identification of human goal is taking place because of lack of right understanding of the human being, lack of right understanding of the existence of the nature. So can we see this? Very important point, because we have gone wrong at the level of understanding, you know, at the level of assumption, which is resulting into a wrong identification of human goal, which is resulting into all kind of actions which are creating these problems. Therefore, if you want to solve them, we have to go back, right? First, we have to identify our goals correctly. Then at the base of that, we have to identify our understanding, right, of human being, our understanding of existence as a whole, nature as a whole, and ultimately the participation of the human being in this nature, in this existence. That we have to understand properly. Only with that understanding, we'll be able to set our goals right, and therefore our actions, our social behavior, our performance of the system will be corrected accordingly, will be taken care of accordingly, in a very natural manner. So look at that. I think there'll be many questions on this. So after the presentation is over, we'll definitely welcome the question. But in the meantime, make a deep investigation into this issue of human goal as such, and what is it for you, you know, as human goal, the one above or the one below. Similarly, if you look at the whole society today, this whole society is working for the human goal mentioned above or human goal mentioned below, the one with the red yellow block or the one with the black block. What is it that we have identified as human goal at the individual level and at the collective level? So if we have the wisdom, we'll be able to identify the human goal correctly. and therefore will be able to work for them. So number one, you have to check whether you have rightly identified the goal or not. Now, once you have identified this human goal correctly, whatever be the particular angle and formulation, but if you are able to identify the human goal properly, correctly, then of course you will, you know, try to work for it in a very natural manner. So what we want to do now is look into some detail about this four human goal that we have identified, right? So let us look at some details in this session. And then we'll also introduce an alternative model to give you a feel that there are possible alternative formulations as well. So let us look at the details of this goal. So here we want to do some detailing about this human goal that we have just discussed. So human goal at the level of society as a collective. Now when we are trying to detail out, we are just asking how to recognize our real goals. So one of the simple suggestions is that if absence of something leads to our unhappiness, we can deduce that it is our real goal, otherwise it is not. So you can define both ways. The absence of something leads to our unhappiness, then it is the, you know, real goal for us. Or otherwise, if the presence of something leads to our happiness, then this is, you know, our real goal. So let's look at that. So we have looked into this, that we want to live, right? And if this is all that is, then the conclusion is living with physical facility. The survival becomes important. But we don't stop there as human beings. We want to live, and we want to live with fulfillment. So when you bring in this fulfillment, then you realize that physical facility alone is not going to work. Something more is required, and that is fulfillment in relationship. And when you realize that even living with fulfillment is not enough, we want continuous fulfillment. So we want to live with continuous fulfillment. If we can identify this, then physical facility and relationship is not enough. Something more is required. And this state of being in continuous happiness has been called by different names, such as bliss, peace, satisfaction, happiness, fulfillment, salvation, contentment, enlightenment, liberation, independence, self-actualization, ecstasy, divinity, well-being of all. So many things in the words have been used in the past, in the tradition. But ultimately what they mean is that we are able to live with continuous happiness. This living with continuous happiness is fulfilled through right understanding in the self that we have discussed. Right understanding the self means understanding of the truth, understanding of the reality, understanding of the existence. Second is fulfillment in relationship. And this fulfillment in relationship expands right up to the feeling of relationship with everyone, that is love and compassion. And third is ensuring more than the required physical facility, that is prosperity. So this continuous fulfillment, living with continuous fulfillment, is equivalent to now having right understanding in the self, right feeling in the self, and ensuring more than the required physical facility, which means understanding the truth, having the feeling of love and compassion, and the feeling of prosperity. So this is what seems to be our goal, our aspiration. And this aspiration can be fulfilled through right understanding, through understanding of truth, feeling of love and compassion, and feeling of prosperity. So if this is the case, the third one that we want to ensure, then we can expand this human goal at different levels. For example, human goal at the level of individual would look like this. The 5 points that we have mentioned. In the self, we want to ensure right understanding, right feeling, and right thoughts. In the body, we want to ensure health. Right? So you can look at them, each one of them, and verify whether we really want this. Right? Or we can do away, you know, without it. So do we want right understanding, right feeling, and right thought at the level of self or not? Do you want health in the body or not? Similarly, recognition of required physical facility, competence for right utilization, and preservation of mind, body, and physical facility. So I should have the competence, right, to take care of my body, my mind, and the physical facility. And when it comes to physical facility, I should have the capacity to identify my need of physical facility. And I must have the competence, right, for right utilization, right, and production of these physical facilities. Then we have to have this ability to live in community with right behavior and right collaboratively. The right behavior and work with collaboration. Fifth is mindset of participation in the larger order, at least in the family order. So that ability to recognize responsibility in the family system and competence to fulfill that responsibility. So at the level of individual, do you think that all this has to be done? Or something seems to be unnecessary? So are these our needs? Does our unhappiness or complaints have to do with lack of competence in these areas? If the absence of this competence makes us unhappy, then this competence are the need of us. So at the level of individuals, we need to ensure this, say, 5 things. So look at each one of them and verify whether they are really needed for you, not needed for you. And if there is absence of it, does it lead to unhappiness? So when I don't have right understanding, right feeling, right thought, then there is problem. It leads to unhappiness. Like that. If you don't have the good health in the body, then we feel, you know, troubled. Similarly, we have listed down this human goal at the level of family, at the level of society, at the level of nature. So I can briefly mention, at the level of family, I have to have the ability to recognize relationship in the family and fulfill it. This is necessary at the level of family. Similarly, it is necessary to recognize the need for physical facility at the level of family, ensure its production at the level of family, ensure its right utilization, right? And if all this is done, ensuring the feeling of prosperity in the family. So we have to have the relationship of mutual fulfillment in the family. We have to have the feeling of prosperity, right, in the family. And of course, in the family, we have to have the ability to look after the next generation. And when we are saying next generation, we have to take care of both their self and their body. Fourth is acceptance of responsibilities that the family is expected to fulfill in the society. its fulfillment with the collaboration with other family. So every family which is embedded in a society has some definite role to play. So if I can see that role and accept the responsibility which are required to be fulfilled in that role, right, then we are able to meaningfully participate in the society as a family. So that is the fourth requirement, fourth goal within the family. Then preservation of family traditions from generation to generation related to meaningful family and societal achievements. This is also very important when we are talking about the family and about the society. Not only that we have to take care of things right now, but we have to take care of the traditions. So there are many things which develop over hundreds of years. So those things which have been developed by different families, different societies over thousands of years or hundreds of years, they have to be identified, and it is the responsibility of the family, responsibility of the society to ensure the continuity of it and the development of it further. So many of the practices in the society, for example, you can see that they have been developed by families, by society over a long period of time. So these have to be carried out by the family, by the society. Here too, because we are talking about the family, it has to be carried out by the family. So a lot of production systems, lot of these medicinal things, they have been developed by specific families or specific, you know, society over hundreds of years. So Ayurveda, for example, is a practice which has been developed over thousands of years, and certain specific aspect of it is carried out by specific families. So even that is very important to contribute to the society, certain system of knowledge, certain practices. The family develop these things and they are identified as that family tradition. So it is important to understand the importance of these traditions family has developed and to ensure its continuity and further development. So like that, we can see at the level of individual, these goals can be detailed out. At the level of family, it can be detailed out. Similarly, at the level of society, it can be detailed out. So I can just read them out without going into much detail. Fulfillment at the level of society, our goal seems to be fulfillment in relationship with relatives, friends, and all those who come in contact. At least feeling of trust, an environment of fearlessness. This is a must, whether we are traveling in the train or we are working in any system. This environment of trust, environment of fearlessness is necessary, is very basic. And this has to be there in the society. Then fulfillment of collective responsibilities, those responsibilities that are required for the societal system to work smoothly and effectively. So we have the society and we have the societal systems to run the society smoothly. The systems have to be functioning. And we as individuals, as part of the family, will have a specific responsibility to perform. So we should be able to perform this responsibility. That is what is required at the level of society. Development of a conducive social environment so that family can feel assured and be able to participate joyously. So that the family can live in a self-organized manner while preserving the family and societal culture and traditions. Similarly, development of a humanistic constitution. So the society has to ensure the development of a humanistic constitution on the basis of which the system can be run, developed, and evolved. Similarly, relationship of mutual fulfillment between all including various countries. So when you look at the society and expand, you know, to the whole family, then we have to ensure this relationship of mutual fulfillment between all, including these various countries that we have. At the level of nature, it is simple, ensuring mutual enrichment with every unit in nature. At the level of individual, family, village, national, international level, we have to ensure mutual enrichment with every unit in nature. And in order to do that, we have to ensure cyclic and mutually enriching process, production processes. So this is, of course, mentioned very briefly, but you can expand it on your own. That when you say mutual enrichment with every unit, a lot of details are possible. And similarly, when you are doing it at the level of individual, family, society, village, nation, it will mean, you know, very, very different thing in terms of details. So this is what we have been talking about, you know, as human goal in our first formulation that we had taken in EHB1, and we are expanding it here. But as I said, there are other possibilities. There can be other formulations about human conduct, depending upon our angle of perception, depending upon our concerns. So let us look at one such possibility. And as I said, that looking into this possibility would help us, number one, to see that there can be alternative, you know, visualization, alternative formulations about the human goal, though the essence will remain the same. So we can see this. And second, we can also see that different, depending upon the concern of the angle, different identifications of human goal will help in giving more emphasis to that particular concern or that particular angle. So probably we'll get a better view of things, you know, through that identification or that model of human goal. So let's look at this another one. So we are saying another formulation of human goal. Here we'll present another possible formulation of human goal at the level of society as a collective. So this is one formulation which has been taken, as I mentioned, in the Indian tradition for a very long time. Right. So we have arranged it a little differently, but we'll rearrange it, you know, for your convenience. So wealth is one requirement. Fulfillment of wishes is another requirement, another goal. Right understanding of natural law is at another, you know, goal. And ultimately the liberation. Liberation is the goal. So you can check for yourself whether this is what you want or not. Do you want wealth? Or you want, you know, scarcity? Whether you want fulfillment of wishes or non-fulfillment of wishes? You want right understanding of natural laws? Or you want to go with confusion, with doubts? And ultimately, you want to be liberated or you want to be bonded? So, in other words, this in Hindi, it says, Arth, Kaam, Dharma, and Moksha. These are the four basic human desires, human goal. And you can verify for yourself whether all these four are required for you or not. Then we are saying that the right order in which effort is to be made is Number one, ensuring right understanding of natural laws. At least ensuring the thought of it. If it is not understanding, at least I have the thought of natural laws. I have learned from someone else, read through some book, but I have some clarity about the natural laws, at least at the level of thought, if it is not a level of understanding. But it is better that it is at the level of understanding. So dharma comes first. Then ensuring rightfully earned wealth. That is us. Fulfillment of wishes, our desire. That is kama. And ultimately the liberation, effort for liberation, that is moksha. So the right order would be dharma, earth, kama, moksha. In essence, in accordance with right understanding of natural laws, ensuring rightfully earned wealth and fulfillment of wishes, ultimately making effort for liberation. So we start with dharma, with the understanding of the natural laws. Then through this understanding, when we implement it with the physical world, we have the wealth. When we implement it with our own self, we have the fulfillment of wishes. And through this, we finally prepare ourselves for living in a state of swatantrata, in a state of complete freedom, which in other words means that I am liberated from all bondages. So these are the four human goals. And then once we identify these four human goals, we can work out some detail about how these goals can be fulfilled. So I'll just briefly mention that. So wealth, for example, the physical facility, the wealth can be ensured by way of natural laws, natural resources, plus the mind and the body, self and the body of human being. So when we invest our labor on the natural resource, we have the production, we have the physical facility. So for example, if I plant a guava plant on the soil and provide the water and other things, then it will grow, right? It will be nurtured, it will grow, and it will give fruits, right? So that fruits coming out of it is an outcome of, number one, the natural resource, the soil, the land, the water, all this. And I putting my thought as well as my effort at the level of body. So that is how the physical facility is ensured through production. And this production is done by way of having the natural resources and we as human beings working on it. So this wealth rightfully earned in accordance with right understanding of natural laws leads to achievement of production, which is in line with the physical, you know, laws. And this results into physical facility, right, which is used for fulfillment of one's physical needs as well as the fulfillment of physical needs of others. So this is the meaning of wealth, the process of ensuring wealth, and ultimately the right utilization of the wealth. So I'm able to see that this wealth has to do with physical facility. I'm able to see that this wealth can be generated by way of putting labor, you know, our mind and body into this natural resource, which is already available. And it is rightly utilized in terms of ensuring, you know, fulfillment of my own need and the need of others in this society. Similarly, wishes can be identified, like fulfillment of wishes. So when we have the understanding of the natural laws, right, and we have this wealth created out of our labor that we have just mentioned. Now we can think of fulfillment of the wishes of oneself, fulfillment of the society, of the family, the whole humanity, and fulfillment of the wishes related to the societal order, the social order, the system. So three types of wishes are important. One relates to our own self. Second relates to the society, you know, in relationship. And third relates to the social order, the social system. The third one is living with understanding of natural laws, that is the dharma. So it is the laws of living in relationship and order, the laws related to order in society and entire nature. So this, when we are talking about these natural laws and understanding of it and living with it, there are two angles from where you can see. One, you can see from the angle of the human being. Right. For human being, what is its purpose? What does it mean? The other, you can see it from the perspective of the nature of the existence. So when we look at it from the perspective of the human being, this is the issue. The laws of living in relationship and order. How I can live, you know, in relationship and order. What are the laws? That is dharma. In other words, the laws related to order in society and entire nature. So if you look at the details, it is living in relationship and order with understanding of natural laws. Which means I have to understand the natural laws, the existential laws. Right? So the understanding this natural existential law, which essentially means understanding the relationship and harmony. And then living in accordance with the behavioral, the societal laws, and the physical laws. So now these existential laws are divided into two parts. One is the physical laws, the other is the behavioral or societal laws. So these laws have to be understood and lived with. So it is to be noted that these behavioral or societal laws and physical laws are existential in nature, not developed in any arbitrary manner by human beings. So this is important to note, that these laws are not the man-made, you know, by his own whims. But these are the laws which are there in existence. Yes. And we have to understand them. So whether it is physical laws or the behavioral laws, they are there in the existence, in the nature, in the being of human being. And we have to understand that. So if you remember what we have been doing right from the first course on UHB, is that we have been trying to understand these underlying harmonies which are there by the very design of nature, very design of existence. And what we can do as human beings is to understand these basic laws and live with that. So the existence is governed by existential laws, nature by natural laws. And these natural laws can be seen in terms of physical as well as behavioral laws. Depending on how much of these laws have been understood, these laws may be articulated in words, in a specific language, in a certain manner by human beings. So these formulations of these natural laws can be in different, you know, from different angles, you know, in different language, in different words, in different manner. But at the base of it is this existential reality, the existential laws, which are there, which we can understand and be with it. So that is the meaning of dharma. The fourth one is liberation. The fourth human goal is liberation. That is to see the existence clearly, to see reality as it is, to be rid of all types of bondages, which are essentially a result of misunderstanding, results of confusions. which essentially means living with understanding of natural laws, plus wealth, plus fulfillment of wishes, and working for the possibility of liberation, liberation from all bondages that we are facing today, whether it is outside or it is inside. And of course, when we make this investigation, we find that the bondages are more inside than the outside. So first we have to work with ourselves. That is what we are trying to do through exercise one and exercise two. So this was just to give you a view of other possible formulations of human goal, and that we are working with one of them, right, one such possibility. So with this presentation, I will open for questions. And before that, I will just briefly mention about these points for self-reflection. So 3 points we have mentioned for your self-reflection. Observe that the problems that we see at any level, whether individual, family, society, or any such level, or at the level of entire nature, are nothing but absence of fulfillment of some part of human goals. So these goals which we have identified, if we are not able to fulfill that goal, then it, you know, pops up as a problem at different level. If we ensure the fulfillment of these goals, then does it seem feasible that we will also get rid of the problems we are facing today? So first part is the statement. Second part is that you have to verify whether this statement is true or not. And if it is true, then can we get rid of the problem that we are facing in the society today by way of working out the solution in terms of fulfillment of these human goals? So if we are ensuring the fulfillment of human goal, will the problem that we have today will automatically be taken care of? Or we'll have to do something to, you know, work with the problems as such. So this is one thing that you have to look into. Second is, what do you see as your goal at the collective level? And is it taking care of all dimensions of our living? So this is important. We have defined human goal taking care of all dimensions of human living. Now you sit down and write down, what is your goal at present? Write down whatever you feel is the goal. And then ask yourself that this goal, does it take care of all the dimensions of human living? So for example, if earning more and more money is your goal, then will it take care of relationship with other human beings? Will it take care of a state of satisfaction, fulfillment within? So like those questions, you know, whether they, the goal that I have in mind is taking care of all these aspects of human being, or it is only limited to certain specific dimensions, specific aspect. Third is, we can make a comparative study of the two formulations of human goal. So we have given two formulations. Right. Can we make a comparative study? And then we are asking, are the differences only at the level of expression, or there is a difference at the level of essence? So look into this points of self-reflection, work on it. So from my side, I will stop. If there are any questions, you are welcome.